Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. Tonight's program is part of the Commonwealth Club's Good Lit series, underwritten by the Bernard Osher Foundation. This program is also being held in association with the Stanford Club of San Francisco and Harvard Law School Alumni Association of Northern California. Our speaker tonight is Scott Turow, and it's my honor to introduce him to you. Of course, he is, by day job, an attorney, and by most notable job for our purposes tonight, a novelist, whose newest work is a novel called Innocent, that I think is fair to say is the long-awaited sequel to the blockbuster novel Presumed Innocent. Scott has a fascinating background. He was born in Chicago, went to Amherst College, graduated in 1970. Then he went to Stanford, received a fellowship at the Stanford University Creative Writing Center, where he attended from 1970 to 72. Later, he became a Jones Lecturer at Stanford until 1975, when he decided to go to Harvard Law School, an obvious career track. After earning his JD in 1978, he became an assistant U.S. attorney in Chicago and served there until 1986. After that, he turned towards much more active, not becoming a novelist, writing legal novels such as The Burden of Proof, Presumed Innocent, Pleading Guilty, and Personal Injuries, which Time magazine named as the best fiction novel of 1999. We're here tonight to hear about his new book, which is a sequel to Presumed Innocent, and its title is simply Innocent. So with that, please welcome Scott Turow.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Roy, for that kind introduction. I have listened over the years to broadcasts from the Commonwealth Club. They were broadcast regularly on public radio in Chicago for quite a number of years, and it was one of those ways that it was just sort of one of those landmarks in my career when I was invited to speak at the Commonwealth Club that I actually realized I had sort of, you know, quote unquote, made it. So it's very nice to be here again. This is the second stop on what, for complicated reasons, is going to end up being roughly 6 weeks of book touring for me. I'm blessed that my books sell overseas, and so next week I go to Italy and the UK and then come back to the United States for more of the same. And people always say, well, you know, how do you feel about doing this? And I have a standard answer that, you know, I have taken depositions in Wichita, and I have been on book tour, and being on book tour is a lot better than taking depositions in Wichita. There are worse things in life than having people pay attention to you. Let's all be honest about that. And I always remember, my good fortune, and frequently say that the only authors I know who complain more about the book tours on which their publishers send them are the authors whose publishers don't send them on book tour. With all that said, though, publication of a book, especially a novel, is a little bit of a strange event. Something that was entirely private is now the subject of widespread discussion, and at least if you're lucky, it is. And sometimes that discussion is conducted in a heartbreakingly callous way. But more to the point, you know, book tour really takes you across what is really the fundamental divide between writer and reader. The truth is, I do what I do in private, and you as readers, those of you who've read my books, do that in private. So this meeting and mingling is, as I say, a trifle odd. even though it's clearly very gratifying for the author. But because of the sort of inherent unusualness, book tour always ends up producing sort of memorable experiences. My first book tour was for the book I wrote about law school, 1L. And it wasn't much of a book tour because the publisher did not really care to support any part of it. So my big media event was taking the train at my own expense from Boston to New York and going on Howard Cosell's radio show. And you know, Cosell, of course, famous sportscaster, sometimes maligned for his supposed arrogance, but you will never hear any of that from me. Manhattan always scared me, and Cosell asked me where I was going next after we had taped this broadcast, and I was going somewhere across town, and it was 5:30 in Manhattan, just as the taxi shift was changing, and he shook his head, and he said, "You're never going to get there." He was quite arthritic. He had bad knees, probably as a result of his own athletic career, whatever it had been. He said, "Come on." And he took me downstairs. We're in the ABC building. He took me down to the street, he walked me out to the edge of the street. And of course, he was at the very height of his fame from Monday Night Football. And, you know, people would gawk at him, and he would make faces back at him. But he knew that eventually some taxi driver, even though he was going off shift, would be curious about what it would be like to have Howard Cosell in the taxi and would stop. And so I'm having trouble with with my little iPad. I'm finding out whether it's a decent medium for using for speaking notes. Finally, a taxi driver did stop, and he, you know, put me in the taxi and, you know, wished me well. But I thought that that was a pretty exceptional thing to do. And, you know, like Cosell, there are many people I've met in the course of book tours whom I never expected to share their company. David Halberstam or Gloria Steinem, you know, who's an iconic figure. I never figured I would be hanging around with Gloria Steinem, and actually sort of had a kind of green room relationship with her. There's the fodder for comic events on book tours. Last night I was doing this, and a man in the front row waved his hand He raised his hand and interrupted me. I said, "Yes, sir." He says, "Some of us have a two-hour drive. When are you going to stop talking and sign the books?" So I've already got the one. I've already got this year's highlight reel covered. I once went to Lexington, Kentucky, and somehow book tour brought me to Three Chimney Farms, where I met Seattle Slew, the Triple Crown champion, who was out to stud. And once I got to see up close and personal what the life of a Triple Crown champion out to stud was like, I have to admit that I thought very seriously for the first time in my life about my prospects for reincarnation. But what was certainly my favorite moment in all of my book tour experiences came in 1993 when my publishers arranged for me to throw out the first pitch at a Cubs game. I am part of that long-suffering legion that adores, for reasons unknown even to themselves, the ever-hapless Chicago Cubs, who of course are echoed in my books by the Kendall County Trappers. This was a big deal to me. I was nervous enough that I actually practiced, and thereby nearly decapitating my oldest child, who was my catcher in those days. And But I thought I was, you know, in good shape until I got ready to go out on the field, and the photographer looks at me and says, "Now, there's just one thing that people sometimes forget." I said, "What's that?" He said, "You have to let go of the ball." So I became nervous all over again. But somehow I got out there, and I threw the pitch from the mound to home plate, and it actually sort of drifted over home plate. This was actually an event that was recalled for many years by my friends who thought that they had seen the equivalent of pigs flying, because Michael Jordan threw out the first pitch a couple of years later when the Cubs finally made the playoffs, and he airmailed his catcher Sammy Sosa. I was pitching to the much less known Eric Yelding. But Yelding, you know, caught the ball, came out, autographed it for me, and, you know, grumbling, "That first strike we've had in 3 weeks." And I was ready to leave the field in triumph when one of the security men came up and grabbed me. And he said, "Mr. Bonilla would like to speak with you." And Mr. Bonilla, of course, for those of you who are baseball fans with a decent memory, Mr. Bonilla was Bobby Bonilla, whom I knew well from his years playing for the Chicago White Sox. And at that time, he was the right fielder for the New York Mets. And Bonilla had acquired a reputation in the press as something of a thug. And that was largely because he refused to speak to the New York sporting press. He just wouldn't talk to them about anything. And he had apparently been chastened by his experiences in other cities. And he just was not, he was not going to talk to these folks. And sure enough, I look up, and indeed, there in fact is Bobby Bonilla sprinting in toward me from right field, full tilt. And I, of course, knowing his reputation and thinking desperately about what have I written about Bonilla or the Mets or even right fielders, and nothing comes to mind. And instead, he arrives breathlessly at home plate and heaving says, "I just heard your name on the PA system. Have your new book in my locker. I'm wondering, will you autograph it?" So, of course, I'm thrilled, I say yes, and realize at that point that I have made the great mistake of my literary career, because it becomes very clear to me exactly what is going to happen. And it's going to happen really in front of many eyes, because not only had my publishers been successful in scouring up lots of literary journalists from, actually some of them came from other cities to witness this event, but of course every sports writer in the building had come down to home plate once they saw Bonilla running in, because as one of my publishers explained, Larry Kirschbaum, they all wanted to know what Bonilla's voice sounded like. So there had to be a good 25 reporters around home plate, and I suddenly could envision exactly what was going to happen, which namely was that the clubhouse man whom Bonilla had sent for the book was going to go into Bonilla's locker, grab the bag with the book, come back up the gangway, run out to home plate in front of this media assemblage, hand the bag to Bonilla, and then from the bag, Bonilla was going to pull out John Grisham's latest novel. But of course, I say it's my favorite moment because it was my novel that Bonilla pulled out of his bag. And of course, from this, I immediately recognized that contrary to the reports, Bonilla was not a thug, but rather a man of discerning literary sensibility. And I tell that story all the time, including once or twice in front of Grisham. And I do have to stop and say that John Grisham is a first-class human being and a first-class citizen of both the literary and the legal world. Anyway, the touring this time is for Innocent, as Roy mentioned. And Innocent is the book I swore I never would write. The success of Presumed Innocent was miraculous in my life. I had written four or five novels that had been roundly rejected by publishers in New York, and I had dreamed of being a novelist since I was a child. My mom wanted to be a novelist, never really managed to get very far with that, but I guess my love and admiration for her was such that I wanted to take on her ambition. And I went to college at Amherst saying I was going to become a novelist. I was eventually was lucky enough to become a writing fellow in the Stegner program at Stanford, the much esteemed Stegner program, and then became a lecturer in the English department. And in my 5 years at Stanford, I wrote a novel, which again had been rejected, called The Way Things Are. And The Way Things Are centered on the implied warranty of habitability. It was about a rent strike, and you can understand why it never saw the light of day with New York publishers, but it did clue me into the fact that I was intensely curious about the law, because even though the publishers didn't think the implied warranty of habitability was very interesting, I did. And so I decided I would go to law school, and naturally, as I say, it proved to be the great break of my literary career. I got through circuitous circumstances a contract to write a book about my first year at Harvard Law School, and a book called 1L that remains in print today. And 1L was nonfiction. When it came out in the fall of 1977, I was in my third year in law school, and people at Harvard Law School had different reactions to it because, as I say, it's nonfiction, and some of them thought that they had been portrayed favorably, and they thought this was a discerning work of literature, and some of them thought they had been unfavorably portrayed, and chief among them was one of my first year professors who claimed that he was the model for the heavy of 1L, a character whom I had called Professor Rudolph Perini. And he even eventually, as curiosity mounted in Cambridge about who was Perini, he even addressed the press on the subject and said he was Perini and he was madder than hell about it. But somehow that did not that didn't completely sink in to me until the end of the first semester of my third year when one of my friends came running up to me with one of this professor's exam booklets from his copyright class. And the last question on the exam went something like this. You are an associate in a large law firm. A senior partner has introduced you to his valued client, Professor Rudolph Perini. Professor Perini has undergone the humiliating experience of having a student, Ray Ripoff, write a book about his daily classroom lectures. Please list all theories under which Professor Perini can sue Ray Ripoff. So one of the net effects of this, of course, was that it taught me that I ought to go back to writing fiction, which, of course, is what I really wanted to do anyway. Despite the success of 1L, I had taken my own measure well. I really enjoyed being a lawyer, and I became an assistant United States attorney in Chicago. But I wanted to remain faithful to that dream I'd always had of becoming a novelist. And so I wrote every morning on the commuter train. It was the only time I really had to do it. I had a young family and a very demanding job, but that 30 minutes that the train ran from Wilmette, Illinois to the Chicago Northwestern Station, I saved for myself and for my writing. And in the space of a year, I went from being a fellow writing on the morning commuter train with the time that I had, you know, cadged from a very demanding life, to being the author of a number one worldwide bestseller, which is what Presumed Innocent became, not to mention the basis for a very successful feature motion picture. And the clamor arose immediately for a sequel to that book. People, of course, wanted more of the same from me, and I became determined absolutely not to write that book. And there were a couple of reasons. One is it struck me as being the height of ingratitude to have been blessed with such extraordinary good fortune and not to try to take full advantage of it. And I realized that writing a sequel to Presumed Innocent would limit me as a writer because I would be imitating myself and I would build myself into a kind of telephone booth as a writer that I would never get out of. And of course, beyond that, I was afraid of competing with myself because that was a competition I could never win. Presumed Innocent, in its own small way, was kind of a path-breaking book. It wrote about lawyers and the courtroom in a somewhat new way. But you know, Ecclesiastes says that you know, you can't step in the same stream twice. And you know, if, as sometimes claimed, I invented the legal thriller with Presumed Innocent, you can't invent the legal thriller twice. So I just said, I always answer the question, no, I'm never going to write a sequel to Presumed Innocent. And that was my resolve for 18 years, and which brings me to the fall of 2005. I went off on book tour for the last full-bodied novel I published, which was called Ordinary Heroes. That was a very personal book. It was based on some of my father's wartime experiences or experiences he claimed to have had. I actually found, after I'd completed the book, that I had a relatively hard time breaking free of it. And you know, my youngest child had just gone off to college. And in that mood, I began to think again about Rusty Savage, and it was mostly an idle thought, I wasn't sure I was actually serious about this. And somehow, while I was out on book tour, I had written on a post-it note the following sentence: "A man is sitting on a bed in which the dead body of a woman lies." I think, to the best of my recollection, that was some kind of transmogrification of a Hopper painting that I liked, where there's a woman sitting on the edge of a bed. But you know, somehow in dreams, things change. And the post-it note, I'd written it down right before I left on this book tour, and it sat there for months. I would move it around my desk, just waiting to sort of write it down in my computer and make something more of it. And around that time, I was contacted by the New York Times, who offered me the chance. They were starting to serialize fiction in the New York Times Magazine, and they said, did I want to write one of these little serialized novellas for them? And for a long time, I'd had an idea about a judge who couldn't decide a case. And I knew it wasn't enough to sustain a novel, but it seemed perfect for this novella, and I said yes. And I've always known what happened to Rusty Savage. It hasn't always made its way into the novels, but I knew, for example, I knew he'd gone on the bench because in the first draft of The Burden of Proof, the second novel I wrote, Rusty had been the judge who performed the wedding ceremony between Sandy Stern and Helen, a scene that my editors suggested that I cut, and which I did, but at least I knew where Rusty was. And so I was on the phone with my agent, Gail Hockman, and I said, well, what would you think If Rusty Savage was the judge who can't decide this case, and there was a long silence, and she said, for 18 years you have told me that you weren't going to write about Rusty Savage again. Now you're telling me that you're going to do it in a story that you yourself admit is not, was not, you know, big enough to be a full-blown novel. And I said, it sounds like you don't think that's a good idea. And she didn't answer that. She's not, you know, she just said, well, you know, if I were you, I'd think twice about it. I put down the phone and I looked at the Post-it note. And the hair really stood up on the back of my head, and I said, wow, that man is Rusty Savage. That's the guy who's sitting on the bed. And, of course, then I said, but who's the woman? Who's the woman who's dead? And it seemed kind of intuitive that had to be Barbara, the woman to whom he was married, and presumed innocent. And then I took another minute, and I'm like, you know, well, how would she die? Why is she dead? And beyond that, what are they doing together? Is this some kind of amorous reunion? And then it's like, did they actually stay married? And I went back and read the end of Presumed Innocent, and in point of fact, Rusty was saying that he had begun commuting up to Detroit, where Barbara had gone with their only child, their son Nat. He was actually talking about some kind of reunion in Presumed Innocent. And once I decided they had stayed married, that was the book. That was the book to me. I knew what I was writing about, which, in a few words, is the way some people cannot avoid making the same mistakes again and again in their lives. I used the writing of this little novella to begin to flesh out Rusty. He appears as a minor character in the novella. The book is told, unlike Presumed Innocent, in a number of voices. One of those is of Tommy Malto, the prosecutor, one of the two prosecutors from Presumed Innocent, who's a character who's evolved throughout my novels. At the end of my fourth novel, The Laws of Our Fathers, Tommy, who was always portrayed as a kind of zealot, I called him a pygmy in his soul. Tommy gives a speech to the judge about the fact that he knew he had been sent to court by the higher ups in the prosecuting attorney's office to lose the case that he was trying, but he didn't care. He came to court every day trying to win it. And I began to think about Malto as a more complicated figure. And certainly central beyond Rusty is his son, Nat, who ultimately has to endure the somewhat unimaginable spectacle of watching his father on trial for the murder of his mother. Anyway, I think that's as much as I'm going to say. I'm going to stop and read the prologue to Innocent, and after that I'll be happy to entertain whatever questions you have, but by reading you the prologue, you can see what became of my Post-it note. A man is sitting on a bed. He is my father. The body of a woman is beneath the covers. She was my mother. This is not really where the story starts or how it ends, but it is the moment my mind returns to, the way I always see them. It's Nat who's talking here. According to what my father will soon tell me, he has not been there. He has been there in that room for nearly 23 hours, except for bathroom breaks. Yesterday he awoke, as he does most weekdays, at 6:30, and could see the mortal change as soon as he glanced back at my mother, just as his feet had found his slippers. He rocked her shoulder, touched her lips. He pumped the heel of his palm against her sternum a few times, but her skin was cool as clay. Her limbs were already moving in a piece like a mannequin's. He will tell me he sat then in a chair across from her. He never cried. He thought, he will say. He does not know how long, except that the sun had moved all the way across the room when he finally stood again and began to tidy obsessively. He will say he put the three or four books she was always reading back on the shelf. He hung up the clothes she had a habit of piling on the chaise in front of her dressing mirror, then made the bed around her, pulling the sheets tight, folding the spread down evenly, before laying her hands out like a doll's on the satin binding of the blanket. He threw out two of the flowers that had wilted in the vase on her night table and straightened the papers and magazines on her desk. He will tell me he called no one, not even the paramedics, because he was certain she was dead, and sent only a one-line email to his assistant to say he would not be at work. He did not answer the phone, although it rang several times. Almost an entire day will have passed before he realizes he must contact me. But how can she be dead, I will ask. She was fine 2 nights ago when we were together. After a freighted second, I will tell my father, she didn't kill herself. No, he will agree at once. She wasn't in that kind of mood, I will say. It was her heart, he will say then. It had to be her heart and her blood pressure. Your grandfather died the same way. Are you going to call the police? I ask. The police, he will say after a time. Why would I call the police? Well, Christ, Dad, you're a judge. Isn't that what you do when someone dies suddenly? I was crying by now. I didn't know when I had started. I was going to phone the funeral home, he will tell me, but I realized you might want to see her before I did that. Well, yeah, I want to see her. As it happens, the funeral home will tell us to call our family doctor, and he, in turn, will summon the coroner, who will send the police. It will become a long morning and then a longer afternoon, with dozens of people moving in and out of the house. The coroner will not arrive for nearly 6 hours. He will be alone with my mom's body for only a minute before asking my dad's permission to make an index of all the medications she took. An hour later, I will pass my parents' bathroom and see a cop standing slack-jawed before the open medicine cabinet, a pen and pad in hand. Jesus, he will declare. Bipolar disorder, I will tell him when he finally notices me. She had to take a lot of pills. In time, he will simply sweep the shelves clean and go off with a garbage bag containing all the bottles. In the meanwhile, every so often, another police officer will arrive and ask my father about what happened. He tells the story again and again, always the same way. What was there to think about all that time, one cop will say. My dad can have a hard way with his blue eyes, something he probably learned from his own father, a man he despised. Officer, are you married? He will ask. I am, Judge. Then you know what there was to think about. Life, he will answer. Marriage. Her. The police will make him go through his account 3 or 4 more times. How he sat there and why. His response will never vary. He will answer every question in his usual contained manner, the stolid man of law who looks out on life as an endless sea. He will tell them how he moved each item. He will tell them where he spent each hour. But he will not tell anybody about the girl. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott, very much. I want to remind our radio audience before we go into our question and answer period that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California Radio, and our guest is Scott Turow, noted attorney and novelist, who's discussing his latest novel called Innocent. We have, as I predicted, quite a few audience questions, Scott, and they range from very specific about your book to somewhat more abstract questions, nothing about the warranty of habitability.
Okay. But, I was prepared to address that at length.
Yes. We'll get to that at the end. There is one question, though, about your reference to your metaphorical self-immolation as a Cubs fan, and it is whether you'd ever thought of switching to the White Sox.
The short answer is no. You know, if that would that really would call for self-immolation.
Someone who really obviously reads your books carefully and thinks about them would like to understand how Rusty could possibly have stayed with his wife all these years.
Well, that, as I say, was to me the essential question, and it was clear to me as I sort of felt this man again that was exactly what he was going to do, and there are a number of reasons for that. One, the most important thing to Rusty Savage is to be a good father. And there's one child, and as I mentioned, his wife had moved to Detroit with his son. And Rusty had a terrible father himself, and so being a good father to his son is the absolute center of his life. And as he expresses it in Innocent, he was reluctant to see his son become the final victim of the many tragedies that Presumed Innocent describes. Beyond that, his wife, Barbara, has now been diagnosed as bipolar and seems to be successfully medicated. And she is, in the lingo, a somewhat different person, especially in the early years after they reunited. So given those two developments, it seemed possible to me that he would make this decision. People, you hear all the time about people staying in relationships where they've been abused in some way, women who were beaten who keep going back to the men who've done it to them. So it didn't strike me as beyond credence. But as I said, knowing he did that, I knew exactly what I was writing about. And the last thing I'd say on that score is Rusty has a clear masochistic streak, and that begins in Presumed Innocent. And it's one of the keys to his character.
The next question has to do with both the benefits and challenges of writing a sequel. And the question points out that obviously some of the characters have been created, so you can build on those. What are some of the limitations when you write a sequel to a novel?
I've stayed in the same created terrain, Kendall County, in each of my novels. Ordinary Heroes was set for the most part in Europe during World War II, but it's still echoed back to Kendall County. So I've been dealing with, the restraints of the previously created world for a while now. Again, my cast of characters in my novels is very often drawn from prior books. And I've done a number of times before what I do with Tommy Malto in this book, which is namely take a character who is sort of either in the background or the middle ground and promote him or her to hero status. And there's a particular richness to me of seeing how the world looks from inside the skin of somebody who's previously just been viewed and categorized in a particular way in the earlier books. The big problem, frankly, was not those kinds of limitations. It was rather the success of the prior book that seemed the most daunting thing to me. At times I felt like I was writing with a vulture on my shoulder, and probably it wasn't until I figured out the end of this book and sort of ran around my house hugging myself for a day or two because I thought I was so clever that I felt fully comfortable with what I was doing.
Again, I remind our radio audience that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California, and our guest is Scott Turow, and we're talking about his new novel called Innocent. Many authors will say that they will start writing and they honestly don't know how the book is going to end. And are you in that category, or do you have a pretty good sense of an outline before you start?
I am in the category of chaos. I I take a lot of time writing without any direction at all. As I said, I mean, the genesis of this book is fairly easy to describe because I had a set of questions to ask myself. And probably the first thing I wrote was the material, the background material, where Rusty explained staying with Barbara. Because, of course, I wanted to see if that would work. You know, if it hadn't, it could have been Rusty's second wife who was lying in that bed. But, you know, just by way of example, Tommy Molto, in Limitations, Tommy had been promoted to the acting prosecuting attorney in Kendall County, so I knew who Rusty's possible antagonist was going to be. And a lot of the writing of Limitations was setting up this book. But, you know, I just started writing one morning in Molto's, from Molto's point of view, because I couldn't figure out how else I was going to get out certain information, and I just wanted to see, well, here's one alternative, I'll try that. And it worked very well, and I just wander blindly that way. An ending at that point is not even remotely in my mind. I just know that, you know, eventually I will create enough that something will occur to me.
Interesting. One of the best favorite dinner conversations is always, will this book become a movie, and is the movie better than the book, or the book better than the movie? As an author, there's two types of questions here, and I'll put them both out there. How much control would you like to have over the screenplay version, and what are the problems of converting a novel into a screenplay form?
Well, I have watched my books be the basis for four films now, the most recent being my third novel, Pleading Guilty, which was in development for a mere 17 years in Hollywood before being filmed last month as a pilot for a Fox television series. And in none of those occasions have I been treated poorly. I've always been treated with respect, part of the reason is because I've understood from the beginning that the film and the book are two separate things. And, you know, it's my book and it's their movie. And they need to make decisions, frankly, that are aimed at dramatically broadening the audience. You know, Presumed Innocent sold 8 to 9 million copies. And at the time the movie was released, if everybody who had bought the book had paid the $5, which was the price in 1990 of a ticket, the movie would only have been $10 million in the red. So obviously, filmmakers need to make decisions that are going to broaden the audience and make these stories comprehensible to a lot of people, and I know that, you know, a lot of subtlety can sometimes get lost, and generally speaking, I think, as I said, things have turned out pretty well for me.
Yeah. Broadening out a little bit, several people wonder what you think about the now digital publication of books and the direct access, whether it be on Kindle or on your iPad or wherever you want to read it. What do you see that trend leading to?
I always like to tease Roger Strauss III, who was at one point the managing director and the man I referred to as my publisher at Ferrer Strauss, because we were once, you know, driving up to my house in Wisconsin, and I said to him, you know, you guys have got to get ahead of the curve, and there's going to be a machine, you know, you'll be able to read on the machine. And his wife piped up and said, "Yeah, and when you get tired, it'll read to you too." And so I have to say, I've seen this coming for a long time. I have no particular problems with e-books. I think that they are not very good for reading daily newspapers. I think there's an experience in reading a broadsheet newspaper that they're not close to capturing. But I've read several novels, and I own both the iPad I brought with me tonight and a Kindle, and I've read several novels on these devices and frankly have found the books as compelling as when I'm holding paper. Obviously, there's no permanence, and for that reason, I imagine people will always want to buy the books they really love so they can have them with them. You know, the digitization of books, and I speak now as somebody who 2 weeks ago became the president of the Authors Guild, the digitization of books presents many challenges. One is the risk of piracy. And as we move into a world where the technology of delivering text is changing and companies are competing to build a better mousetrap, we face a serious threat of somebody through the use of intellectual property laws trying to monopolize the means of delivery of text. And that will not be a good thing for our literary culture if that's what happens. And that's certainly, you know, one of the great overriding concerns of the era that we're entering.
And a corollary question is whether an author whose name becomes sufficiently well recognized could directly self-publish digitally.
Stephen King tried to do that, and I think it was just largely experimental. He has always had good relationships with his publishers, and he found that it was a real nuisance to do that. I think publishers, have a significant function, a good editor, and I've had a couple of really good editors, both John Galassi and Deb Futter, who edited Innocent, are really good editors, and they add a lot. And I wouldn't want to try to write a book without an editor. I think my publishers at Grand Central have done a bang-up job of promoting this book based on what they've done in the first week or so, and that too is value-added. So I think the idea of, you know, so-called name-brand authors self-publishing is probably fanciful. I don't think it's something that's going to come to pass.
Again, I remind our radio audience that we are the Commonwealth Club of California, and you're listening to Scott Turow. We're discussing his latest novel, Innocent. I'm going to broaden the questions out now because quite a few people are interested in some of the issues you've gotten into through your practice of law.
Sure.
And one of them has to do with the death penalty.
Mm-hmm.
And the direction you see the courts and our society going with regard to that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I fearlessly predicted that before this century is over, the United States will give up capital punishment. It's an easy prediction to make since I won't live to find out whether I'm right or wrong. But I still feel that the trend line is really relatively clear. We are alone in the developed world, along with Japan, in practicing capital punishment, and many countries and many people in other parts of the world simply can't fathom why we do it. They regard us as brutes for practicing capital punishment, and I think as the world becomes smaller, there will be increased foreign pressure on the United States to give up capital punishment. The other reason that I say this with such confidence is that I think people are beginning to realize that the death penalty just doesn't give them what they think it's for, which is the kind of clarion call of moral clarity. That's just not the way the system functions. What, of course, has underlined this most clearly are the repeated exonerations of people who've been convicted and sentenced to death. And the only really, I admire prosecutors who are willing to say that if we have capital punishment, every now and then we're going to execute an innocent person, because that's the nature of the death penalty. When you save a penalty for the worst of the worst, as death penalty jurisprudence is sometimes summarized, you are talking about the cases that will most excite the passions of a community of prosecutors, of judges and juries, and it means that those cases are the most vulnerable to mistake. Now, if Americans are willing to say we'll have the death penalty and every now and then execute somebody who's innocent, they'll retain the death penalty. But they're not. And the reason they're not is because they want moral clarity out of the death penalty. So it's completely incompatible to have a system that will every now and then bring this most catastrophic result that you can imagine.
And one question points out the relationship of the recent DNA research to finding wrongful convictions. Yes. And whether that influences the issue.
Well, DNA has been a remarkable revelation in establishing the innocence of a number of people convicted of truly grave crimes. And I have to say, in this connection, no one deserves more credit than my friend Barry Scheck. I really believe that if there's an American alive who deserves the Nobel Peace Prize, it is Barry for what he has done to bring DNA into the courts. And of course, DNA is also a very powerful tool for prosecutors. But the one mistake that people make, a lot of prosecutors talk about the CSI effect, where juries are upset if there's only witnesses on the stand. They want that scientific evidence. And in most cases, of course, there's not genetic evidence. You're not going to have DNA in most criminal cases. The greatest mass murderer in the history of the United States, Timothy McVeigh, if we leave out the people who committed the crimes on 9/11, McVeigh was convicted on a circumstantial case without any scientific evidence in the nature of DNA. So it's been great in what it's done to propel exonerations, but it's not the whole answer to our justice system.
You have experience, of course, working within the federal criminal justice system. And our society is engaged in a debate right now about the appropriate tribunal for trying what I will call enemy combatants or terrorists. The two most recent cases are the so-called 20th hijacker, and then these two recent cases with the several types of bombers. Right. I won't get into the garments that they used. What are your views on the use of the federal court versus the military tribunal?
I think it really depends, and this is an issue that I have followed very closely. If you're talking about somebody who is arrested under arms in behalf of an enemy in a foreign territory, that's one thing to say that we're going to impose and authorize the use of a military tribunal. But the suggestion, which has been carried out in the case of Jose Padilla, that an American citizen can be arrested on American soil and held without access to the civilian courts, I have a very hard time understanding what there is in that scenario that distinguishes our society from the ones that I was brought up to abhor, the so-called totalitarian societies, the Stalinists in Russia and the Maoists in Red China. I don't comprehend the argument
that the government can simply take hold of an American citizen and imprison him without the due process of law. And I think that is a very dangerous path for us to go down.
In that same vein, someone asked about the rights of people in Guantanamo to have access to habeas corpus and access to the federal courts.
Right.
Your position on that?
Again, that Guantanamo is a more complicated issue. You're talking about, for the most part, almost exclusively foreign nationals, most of whom at least are allegedly apprehended under arms for enemy forces. And, you know, the Supreme Court's frankly answered the question. They've said they do have the right to habeas corpus. It's the way I hope the court would answer the question. And I have no problem with it. I mean, the Congress keeps trying to define it out of existence, and the Supreme Court keeps saying, you know, look, folks, we agreed when we started to do things a certain way, and we're going to keep doing them that way.
The Supreme Court will, at the retirement of Justice Stevens, have a vacancy. And what would you be looking for in terms of the qualifications of the justice to be appointed to that position?
Well, you can answer that question in lofty, noble ways. Or you can answer him as with political purposes in mind. Our judicial nomination process as a whole has become the captive of ideologies. And naturally, I prefer to see my ideology triumph over somebody else's ideology. So what would I be looking for? I would you know, play the game as it's been played. I would look for somebody who's relatively young so that they can stay on the court as long as Justice Stevens has. I would look for somebody whose life experience suggests that he or she will be capable of responding to the changes in the times that they're going to serve. And I certainly would look for somebody whose life experience is broader than simply, you know, having, frankly, been broader than mine. You know, I grew up in the city of Chicago, went to suburban high school, and, you know, a little Ivy college, and Stanford and Harvard Law School. I've led a very privileged life, and I'd like to see somebody there who perhaps has a broader perspective than that.
One of the aspects of the court right now that it is really, that I believe the first time in its history, at least the questioner suggested, is is that every justice on there has been an appellate court justice.
Mm-hmm.
And there are arguments of both ways. Do you think that is a good or a perhaps questionable constituency?
I have no inherent distrust of appellate court judges. I know when I was an assistant U.S. attorney and would read these opinions, I would sit there and think, when are they going to appoint somebody who's been a trial judge to the Supreme Court? I mean, for one thing, they would at least take some cases dealing with the rules of evidence, which they do very infrequently. I don't think it's good for an institution like the Supreme Court to be the captive of any one particular set of life experiences. And that's what you risk when you have only appellate court judges on the court. And so, yes, I would like to see the experience base broadened.
Maybe a specialist in the warranty of habitability.
Maybe so.
Let me remind our radio audience one more time. This is the Commonwealth Club of California, and we're delighted to have Scott Turow, both an attorney and a novelist, discussing his latest novel, Innocent. For last question, somewhat broad, and you can take it as broadly as you want, and that is, as a society, we seem to have a fascination with crime, mm-hmm. And I mean, the number of crime, terror, investigation programs on television, it seemed to outnumber everything. What do you think that is, and what might it mean about our society?
Usually when there's this kind of a fixation, it represents a number of different impulses, some of them are contradictory. Obviously, one thing about crime is that it justifiably scares everybody. And so people like to hear again and again the story that, you know, crime doesn't pay, and that, you know, malefactors are going to be caught and punished. And to make it convincing, of course, they want to know exactly how that happens. But of course, the fascination with crime, which Lord knows I share, it's really what's animated my life, both as a lawyer and as a novelist. The fascination with crime is deeper than that. Crime is, you know, to use a fancy academic word, transgressive. And I say with obviously a measure of humor, but also some sincerity, that criminality is one of the great forms of the exercise of human imagination. Lawyers are always sitting in their offices shaking their heads going, you know, how in the world did he even think of that? And so there is a piece of criminality that we're bound to admire, people think outside the box. You know, who would think of hiding in a grocery store, you know, on a shelf and putting the products back up in front of himself so that he can rob the place after the doors are closed? It will always hold a certain fascination, both for the fears it inspires and the imagination that it exhibits, and the imagination that's also exhibited by law enforcement dealing with these problems.
Well, I want to thank you very much, and I want to say to our audience here and to our radio audience that this program has been part of the Good Lit series, underwritten by the Bernard Osher Foundation. It's also been held in association with the Stanford Club of San Francisco and Harvard Law School Alumni Association of Northern California. And Scott Turow, I want to thank you very much for a very informative and pleasant evening.
Appreciate it. Thank you all. Thank you all for being here.